Confirm the word with revelation. We thank you, Lord. Again, tonight, we're leaving here different than the way we came in. In Jesus' name, everyone shouted amen. Glory to God. You may be seated. Turn with me, if you would, to John. Glory to God, the 14th chapter. Man, I really, really appreciate those young men, don't you? You know what? They could be doing anything else. As a matter of fact, they were doing other things. And then God jerked the slack out of them and gave them an anointing and a calling that was without repentance. And now they're reaching those, come on, that need to hear Jesus. And again, like I said, man, I don't know. To me, it was great revelation. Rhema with a beat. The spoken word. Glory to God. So again, if you want some good Holy Ghost Christian music and rap, we got that in the back there. I believe you brought your CDs, didn't you guys? Glory to God. All right. John chapter 14. I just want to ask you a question. Are y'all right? Y'all all right?
Amen.
Did I get whiter or something? Y'all looking at me funny like I'm now all of a sudden I'm not white, I'm clear. What? Are you all right? Some of y'all are just looking right through me. We want to just joke a little bit because some of y'all, you know, you've had a hard week already. But you know what? When the word has been sown, the enemy is coming immediately to steal that which was sown. I can't tell you how many revivals we've been into. Some have extended 6 weeks and longer, 2 months. And the Lord has shown me a revelation because people would come to me and say, I love the meetings. I felt freer than I've ever felt. I got something from God. But as soon as I left the church, junk started hitting the fan. And I said, that's good. They didn't understand my praise. I said, you just told me the word was sown. If the word was not sown, then the devil has nothing to come immediately to try and steal. That's why you'll see sometimes during special meetings, Pastor, which you've been doing this 30 years, and thank God they've been faithful to that call. I think they've been married, how long y'all been living together before that? You were, no, I'm teasing. They've been married a long time, and they are a precious example of a Holy Ghost couple as a ministry couple. And I'm here to tell you, when special services have been going on, even when you've held them, it's funny how the stuff tries to come up. Now, isn't it amazing, too? Now, we know special services are better than our jobs. But we'll do everything it takes to get there. Why? Because we see the reality of getting paid there, but we don't see the rewards of the... Come on, just snap your fingers to the beat. Come on. Ha ha. That one is beating you in the forehead right now. Come on. I'm telling you, if you understood the rewards of sowing, you would know that the devil will never have control over your finances again. Because you can sow your way out of any famine, sow your way out of any pestilence, sow your way out of any... I sowed my way, as I told you before, out of foreclosure.
All right.
Because the money I had didn't have enough to catch up, so I just sowed what God told me to sow. And God, supernaturally, through one person, unbeknownst to the situation, gave us a check. Say, God told me to give you this. And I said, I believe He did. I believe He told you to give it last week, too. But that's all right. I'm not going to judge you. I got it. All right, now... The bottom line is this, when the word's been sown, there's something the devil doesn't want you to get because that word sown is going to produce great works on the inside of you. And that great work is going to be a detriment to him and a deficit to him and a defeat to him if you start operating and that word grows into a harvest. So it says in Mark 4, when the sower sows the word, the enemy comes immediately to steal that which was sown. So if stuff's happening to you immediately, just weather it out. Take authority over it. Tell them, I see what you're up to. I command you to stop in Jesus' name. And let that word permeate your being. Let that word soak every situation that you have. Let that word take you to new levels that you've never known before. Let that word take you to greater heights than you've ever had before. Let that word take you to a greater depth so that root system will produce a fruit system that will never dry up. Now, I know it's a Wednesday night Bible study, but I'm getting warmed up. Hold on. So John 14, verse 12, Jesus speaking, verily, verily, it means listen up. I say unto you, he that believes on me, the works that I do shall he do, and greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father. Who wrote this? The Holy Spirit through men, you understand, unctioned by the Holy Ghost, or recorded the fact that Jesus said this. Just because it's written by a man that was unctioning under the Holy Spirit doesn't mean that it still wasn't Jesus' words. Jesus said this, and if it's written and read, I always say it must be read. He said, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, the works that I do shall you do." That right there is amazing. If we stopped right there, we could go home. Praise God. But he said, "Greater works than these shall you do, because I go unto my Father." Now very quickly tonight, I'm going to talk to you about doing greater works. Well, brother, I got it. Now this is always from somebody that reads the Bible like once a year around Easter. Now, brother, I said, "Whoa, wake up!" I said, "Brother," it was as if I didn't even do that. Appreciate Pastor Joshua here and Urbanly, right? All right, and his wife, Tanya Lou. They're from a brand new church in Broken Arrow called Element 26. Had the opportunity to minister that last night. Great church, great people. Actually had Pastor Josh as a student one time. It was awesome. Praise the Lord. And I gave him an A just because I liked him. All right, anyway. I'm still going to be me. You can still be you, but it don't look good. All right, now, here we go. Somebody smile anyway. Get excited. Hallelujah. All right. Yeah, I might just have them come up and rap again, and then I'll just start all over, and we'll just be here till 12 if you want to keep playing with me. All right. Now here's what happens. Greater works is what we're called to do. Jesus didn't just say, if there's a pastor out there or a minister out there or an evangelist out there that's good. He said, the one that believes. Say, I'm a believer. Come on, if you're a believer, then you are candidates right now to do great works and greater works. So let's go to Matthew 4. And there's a parallel in Luke 4, but we're going to look here in Matthew 4. Because we looked here last week at what happened when Jesus came to the river and got baptized by John the Baptist. And he was thrust or led into by the Spirit of God into the wilderness. At the end of his wilderness experience, we understand he had great victory. And in that wilderness experience, he then comes out of the wilderness, not just led by the Spirit, not just filled by the Spirit, but Luke 4 records, comes back out in the power of the Spirit. And it goes on in Matthew chapter 4, and look at verse 17. It says, From that time that Jesus was baptized in the Jordan, and the Spirit of God came upon him. From that time, when the Holy Ghost was upon Jesus, look what happened. He began to preach and to say, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." Glory to God. It goes on in verse 23, and Jesus went about all of Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the gospel of the kingdom. Every time you see Jesus preaching and teaching, he's talking about the kingdom. It would behoove us, I don't know, I just like that word. It would behoove us all to start looking and see what kingdom means. Now, I'm going to throw this out for you in your study. There's to a lot of people, there's no difference between the kingdom of God and the kingdom of heaven. But I beg to differ. What I've seen in the word, studying the kingdom, which means king's domain, king's dominion, kingdom. Come on, we are all kings and priests according to the word. And he is the king of all kings. Come on, it's not just those other majestic people out in a European country somewhere. We are now kings and priests. He is the king of all kings, but he's given us the rules and understanding and teachings of the kingdom, which means the king's domain or king's dominion. You cannot operate in a kingdom if you don't know you're a king. You cannot operate in kingdom dominion if you don't know your dominion and domain. Pride is always trying to get the devil to come in. Come on now. Let me say it this way. Exactly how God gave it to me in prayer. He said, "Son, whenever you go into the enemy's arena trying to whip him, that's pride. But humility is knowing he can't whip you in yours." Let me give you an example. Somebody cut you off in traffic. Anybody else know about that?
Yes.
Anybody do that? All right, good. I'm an equal opportunity employer. But here's the thing. Whenever somebody cuts you off, you're not in a good mood, boom, they're fleshing out, they're throwing up gestures, you guess they're deaf, they're throwing sign language at you, you know, and you're like, I don't understand, oh, I understood that one. All right, now anyway, so, and we're driving and we're angry, they're angry, we're in the flesh, I'm trying to beat them in their arena, which the enemy has sucked me into. I'll never win in that as a king's kid. The only way we win is knowing our domain, our dominion, knowing the kingdom, knowing its principles, and knowing as a king's kid, in this kingdom, I can't be defeated. Come on now. I am more than a conqueror. I am victorious right now in this life. In this kingdom, there's no sickness. That's why he's giving us an understanding of the difference between the kingdom of God and the kingdom of heaven. The kingdom of God is a system. The kingdom of heaven is a place. Is this Bible study tonight? Kingdom of heaven is a place. The kingdom of God is a system. That's how he can take the system of which is operating in another place than what you're at right now and allow you to be seated in a place you're not actually supposedly in the flesh yet, but your spirit man is. So I can say this, because I'm seated with him in heavenly places, I can do greater works. Because I'm seated with him in heavenly places, I'm just as much in heaven right now as I am on this earth. So the authority that he has given me from heaven, I can operate in that authority here on this earth right now.
Yeah.
Right. Where other people can't get earthly things to change, you and I can because of a heavenly authority on this earth. That which is impossible to man is possible with God. And now, if I'm God's kid, if I'm in his kingdom and in his principles, I don't have to wait till I get to a place before I can operate in this. I can operate in this place right now, knowing that the principles that are there, he's given to me as a system and placed it within me through his word and his spirit. Therefore, I can have heavenly results on an earthly plane. Come on, somebody shout greater works. Somebody say good bedtime story, Pastor. Keep going. All right, now here. We see now in Matthew chapter 4, in verse 23, Jesus went about all of Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the gospel of the kingdom, healing all manner of sickness and all manner of disease among the people. Oh, it gets better. And his fame went throughout all Syria. And they brought unto him all sick people that were taken with divers diseases, torments, and those which were possessed with devils, and those which were lunatic, and those that had the palsy, and he healed them. And there followed him great multitudes of people from Galilee and from Decapolis and from Jerusalem, from Judea, and from beyond Jordan. Now, you got to understand, when did he start preaching this? When did he start preaching this? Right after he had the Holy Ghost come upon him and gave him the power. Anybody got the Holy Ghost in here? Then number one, you're led by that Spirit. I would suggest you start praying in that spirit if you're wanting to be led by that spirit. Come on, the more we pray in the Holy Spirit, the more the leadings will be easier. The still small voice will be the loudest voice you hear, the loudest voice you know, the loudest voice that makes sense. Did you know somebody came to me one time again after a series of meetings and said, "Brother, I've been hearing the devil talk to me all day." I said, "Okay, are you talking back?" Because the point is, you're not supposed to be talking back and having a conversation with the devil. The devil keeps talking to you because he's trying to get you to, one, believe what he's saying, or two, speak what he's saying, so that if you believe and speak what you're hearing, even if it's against the word of God, it'll begin to manifest in your life. For instance, how come every time I do this, this always happens? Every time I did, my mama had it, my grandmother had it, now I guess I've got it.
All right.
The devil is not a creator. He's a counterfeiter. That's why he needs your voice to create in this earth. Come on, look at your neighbor and say, "Shut up." Now, here's the thing. Too many times we're going through life and we begin to repeat and to report what we're seeing as if it's fact. What we studied here last week, we know that we call those things that be not as though they were. So that means if it's supposedly God's word, come on, and I don't feel like it, then what the enemy's trying to say to me is irrelevant. What he's trying to make me feel is irrelevant. We've got to stop believing he's got so much power and authority. I like something that I heard here recently. A little officer, let's say the size of, I don't know, he's this tall, he's this wide, but he's got a badge. He's an officer of the law. A giant Mack truck who has so much power to run this little man over. But because he's got a badge, because he's got a whistle, he's got something called authority. And with that authority comes power. And he's able to stop with just a hand that Mack truck as long as the driver's cooperating. You understand in theory what I'm saying. Well, here's the thing. Cancer, sickness, disease, sometimes it does appear to be big and it sometimes appears to be very powerful. But the problem is it may have power, but it has no authority. Which means this, the smallest little woman with sickness and disease can put up her hand because she's got the badge of the Holy Ghost, because she's got the whistle of the Word of God, can begin to blow and to put up her hand and say, stop in the name of Jesus. And because she's got authority given by God Almighty, that powerful thing does not ever manifest. It bows down to the power and authority of that little woman. Oh my God.
Yes.
Ha ha ha. Like God said to me one time, it's just a giant. Why are you tripping? It's just a giant. David didn't trip. It's just sickness. Don't trip. Just because you get a bad report, it is not a death sentence. It's just trying to challenge you with the power it has. But you have been given authority and power over all of that stuff. As a matter of fact, if you're sure about the report, well, it said that there was something in my brain. No, it's not. It's under your feet. If you really want to know where the sickness is, it's not there. It's under your feet.
Yes.
So to do the works of the Lord, we got to understand what he did. We got to understand who we are in Christ. Come on. And it says here he went everywhere teaching, preaching, and healing. Which means this, the teaching brought revelation. The preaching brought inspiration. The healing was demonstration. Everywhere went, come on, teaching, preaching, and healing. So that means he brought information, he brought proclamation, and he brought manifestation. He brought information, he brought inspiration, and he brought demonstration. All of it together. Not one or the other. It wasn't that he was having an information meeting over here and then an inspiration over here for the flakes. Come on. He wasn't having a word meeting over here and then a Holy Ghost blowout over here. It was the whole thing together. The Word and the Spirit and the demonstrations together. So guess what? Everywhere you go. I mean, something's changed in me. I refuse to believe it hasn't. As a matter of fact, some stuff has changed so much in me in the last 2 weeks that I even looked at her and I said, are we doing anything different? Come on, I'm talking about people that they don't know us. Just weird stuff. Even today, at lunch, a date. Romance, keeping the fire alive. Come on, everything you told me, I've been reading in that book that you gave me. I've got it's working, Pastor. I'm just kidding. All right, now that book that Pastor James wrote, How to Be Like Me, a Daddy Mac. How to Be a Pimp from the Pulpit. I love that chapter. That was awesome, Pastor. I'm messing with it. He and I are very close, and we were very close, so. He's sitting there going, I knew not to have it. But anyway, so. This man comes up and he says, I'm sorry, did I overhear? You're a pastor. And I thought, I might as well just scoot over. He is going to sit down on my lap if I don't scoot over. And he was a nice guy. He just kept talking and talking. And he's just telling us about what he does and everything. And I'm just sitting there. That I couldn't order because he was blocking. He was order blocking me. You know, I mean, he wouldn't let the lady in to take my order. And I'm just like, hey, I love you, but I want some fajitas. You know, come on now. And so he just kept talking. Very nice man. And he was very interesting. And he was sitting in the booth right next to us. And at one point, his food came out and he shut up. was like, thank you, Lord. Because I know when my food comes out, he's going to be done. Anyway, so he just wanted to keep talking. But you know what? I really got into what he was saying. I thought, what a nice guy. This is strange. Not that people won't come up to us, but this today alone, I can't tell you how many people just kept coming up that didn't know me and started talking to me like they knew me. Well, this man, before he leaves, he throws money down on the table. Aren't you glad I didn't get angry? I'm more glad than you are. Come on now. Because the Lord is good. His mercy endures forever. And I'm telling you right now, God will pay you wherever you're at. And he will bring people across your path you don't even know to drop money on your table just by you doing what you're called to do. Oh, wait a minute. It's got to be my hair. It's got to be the beautiful wife. Oh, it's just got to be this. It might have to do with me being open, but I'm definitely, you understand, we are not the most what she is, but I am not the most beautiful person in the world. I'm just telling you, there's some light that shines and attracts people to you. And the thing is, you've got to let it. Don't be praying, Lord, use me, speak through me, do whatever you want to do. Look out of my eye gate, speak out of my mouth, do whatever. I'm yours, I'm your labor. Dad, use me, use me. And somebody comes along, you're like, get out the way, fool. Right. Why are you messing with me? I am busy. Don't you see this is my day off? I got my hat on. What is going on? Yeah, I'm a pastor, but can't you tell I'm off today? Come on, as a minister, you're never off. Well, you don't have a day off. You might get off, but you don't have a day off. So anyway, everywhere he went, he went teaching, preaching, and healing. In Matthew chapter 23 through 24, very important. These are works that he did. If he cast out devils, you can cast out devils. If he healed all sickness, you can heal all sickness. Somebody said, I can't heal nobody. Yes, you can if he gave you that power. Because we're not hearers only, are we? We're doers. What are we doing? Which is what? I love how people say that. Can I just get, I'm going to get a little bit crazy here, a little bit. Yes, I can get more crazy. Here you go. If anybody comes up to you and says, I know what you meant, but I've heard people say this, I'm a doer of the word, which means to them, just they confess it. And they try to live by the ones they accept. But a doer of the word is one that will step out of their comfort zone and actually manifest the results the Word says you can have. Ooh, come on now. I love how people say they're doers of the Word, but you got to fight them to tithe. Has anybody got a bulletproof vest I can borrow just for, is anybody else not wearing their, all right, listen. The bottom line is, God cannot make us do anything. That's why our human will is involved to do the mighty works. Why are we not seeing more mighty works? It's not because they're not available. We're seeing them. Come on. So what is it? Why are we not seeing them like we should? The bottom line is that we're scared of what people will think. What if they reject me? So? You that in tune with you? You care? Who replaced the happy Northside with the angry Northside? Come on, what happened now? I'm telling you, one reason we are not effective witnesses is, number one, we don't witness. The other part is we don't witness because we're scared of what people will think. I'm not cool. Oh, man, thank God Smith Wigglesworth didn't care if he was cool. You know what's not cool? It's coming to a meeting. And a minister's ministering named Smith Wigglesworth. And they bring the guy to the meeting and said, this is his last hope. They send him home to die. And these two friends are holding up this guy that's about to die. And they're holding him up in front of Wigglesworth in the healing line. Thank God he wasn't too cool to come up and punch him in the stomach. He goes, what ails you? He goes, our friend's dying. He was sent home. We thought, well, we might as well bring him to a meeting where healing is. Maybe he'll get healed. That's the first place you should go, not the last place. I can't tell you how many times somebody said they couldn't come to one of my services because they were sick. Yeah, don't come, please. Only come if you're healed to see healings. But anyway, and so Smith goes like this, wham, right up in his rib cage. The man collapses and he dies. The music kept going, so keep it going, all right? The music kept going, and he's praying for different ones. Let that clump of dead flesh, just brand new, it doesn't even stink yet, laying in the floor. He gets there, and they come running up. Brother Wigglesworth, you know, because they don't punch me. But Brother Wigglesworth, our friend, you killed him. He goes, he's not dead. He lives. What are we going to do? I don't know. He's obviously dead. The guy's crazy. He just killed him. And he said, he's not alive, is he? No. That look off into the space like he's doing. He's not alive. Okay, well, we need to talk to him because he's the one that killed him. But I don't want to interrupt him. He seems to be angry and he hits people. And he apparently knows Demok, which is the death touch. So I don't know. And so, sorry, Brother Wigglesworth.
What?
We just wanted to let you know, our friend is dead. You killed him.
He's not dead, he liveth.
And he picks the man up and starts slamming him up against the wall.
I command you to bring forth life into this man's body. Life, come back.
I know the person that was about to get prayed for was probably thankful and said, you know what? I can live with what I got. It ain't that bad. It's just stage 4 cancer. I'm good. I got a few more months, but I'm good. I'm fine. And so can you imagine the man? He's in heaven. Last thing he sees is this wild man, boom, and him collapse to the floor. The last thing he saw was that. The next thing he saw was Jesus, and he's like, that man. And this is what happens. He's talking with Jesus, looking at heaven, the beauties of heaven. And the next thing he is getting slammed up against the wall by this crazy man that killed him once already. Screaming, I command you to live. He came back. Ah! Come on now. If you just got dropped by a man and you went to heaven and you come back into your body and he's slamming you up against the wall, he's like, come on, you already killed me. Why are you trying to kill me twice? But he lived. I said he lived. And the two friends, thank God Wigglesworth wasn't too cool to do what God called him to do. It appeared he died. Medically, he may have. It appeared that the friends thought he died. Not judging them either. But what's amazing is Wigglesworth picked that man up because he knew that he was to live. Kept slamming. Some of us would be like, well, you know what? I'm sorry. I tried. I don't want to get crazy. I don't want people to think I'm bizarre. I don't want to get persecuted because we all know that persecution is the sign that you're not doing God's work. We know that. Persecution is the banner to the one that obeys God.
All right. Glory.
Matthew chapter 7. Glory to God. Are you getting anything tonight?
Yes.
Glory to God. If you need to order your pizza, go ahead and order it here. You can pick it up and bring it here. We'll be done in a minute. Actually, have them deliver it. Who's buying, first of all? That's what I thought. Love the midweek church blues. Matthew chapter 7, verse 29. Jesus taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. So we know this, scribes taught. We know Pharisees taught, but they only taught what had become structured and accepted. So when one starts going outside of that which man has set up as structure and what man has come accustomed to accepting, when you start teaching outside of those boundaries and getting results, that is one that teaches with authority. Ooh, glory to God. So it's not just about shouting and being powerful from a performance standpoint, because Jesus did that with his teaching. He did that with his preaching. But the thing is, he didn't stop it with his demonstration and his healings. Which means what? That means a lot of times we throw out the word and we want the word to do its work. And we say we're doers of the word. But come on now. If I'm a doer of the word, that means I'm healed. I don't feel like it. My feet hurt, my ankles hurt, my hips hurt, my back hurts, my stomach hurts, my shoulders hurt, my arms hurt, but I'm going to get up and I'm going to dance and run around this place anyway. Why? Because I'm a doer of the word, which says what? By whose stripes ye were healed, were met you were. That means past tense. 2,000 years ago when he said, it is finished. Matthew chapter 8 and verse 5. And when Jesus was entered into Capernaum, there came unto him a centurion, beseeching him, saying, Lord, my servant lies at home, sick of the palsy, grievously tormented. Now let me ask you this. Can you hear the word and faith not come? It's impossible. Because faith and the word are inseparable. That's why he gave you the word, to have faith. Come on. Faith comes by
hearing.
And hearing by the word of God. But although faith comes, that doesn't mean you got it. So I ask again, can the word be preached and faith not come? No, faith will always be there. But it's what Hebrews says, is how do you hear? Mixing faith with what you've heard. Your own natural part. Being open. So faith comes, but did you accept it? Are you acting on it? Or are you a hearer only? Faith comes through hearing, not having heard. But a lot of times we think because we've heard it, we've got it. It's more than that. You've got to act on what you've heard to have the result of what you've heard ministry or what you've read. Can you hear? Based on the centurion, let me say this. Can you not hear and have faith? Come back next week. Come on, can you not hear and still get faith? How many of you in here studied the Word of God? Got the concordance out? You got the Greek and the Hebrew and swung on the suppository dictionary of vines. Come on. Come on. How many of you in here started meditating on all the Bible scriptures on salvation before you got saved? I know you ain't going to like it, but it's going to help you. Take your broccoli tonight, honey. Come on. I didn't study or meditate any length of time when I asked Jesus to come into my heart. And that was basing my eternal salvation. But when it comes to benefits of salvation, I got to have all these scriptures. I got to get out the Word of God. I got to get out the vines. I got to get out the concordance. I got to get out all the DVDs and CDs on healing. I got to study. I got to study. I got to study. I got to get this. Okay, wait a minute now. Wait. You're talking about a temporary situation in your body. You cannot use your same belief system you had in the beginning, come on, that He gave you with to believe for eternal salvation forever and ever. Amen. And you're having a temporary situation in your body or your finances, and it's taking you that hard to believe the same thing? Well, brother, to whom much is given? Come on. You can... What did Jesus say? Only... So that tells me we've complicated it. Yeah. I gotta have the 1, 2, 3, the A, B, C. Come on. The O, P, P. Yeah, you know me. Come on. No. But here, the centurion. Smelling smoke. I just want to move from the lightning then. But. And saying, Lord, my servant lies at home, sick of the palsy. Notice what's lying at home is his servant, not another soldier. I said his servant, not a soldier. And when you're at home with this bad of a state of palsy, that means you've been with this for a while. You can't serve real good when you're this sick of the palsy. You can't serve this good for a long time if you're this sick of the palsy. So what's going on? What's going on is this. Is he and this servant had a relationship and he loved this guy. Come on now. This was like a family member. This was a brother. It wasn't a soldier. It was somebody he had a heart connection with. That's why he was still his servant when he was unable to serve.
sick of the palsy, grievously tormented, cannot serve like he's known to serve in the past. That means he's known it for a long time. The centurion comes up to Jesus and says these words. It just blesses me. Get a hold of this, for submission and authority is in operation right here. And he said to him, come. Or he said, I will come. Jesus said, I will come and heal him. The centurion says, no. Wait a minute. He heard that Jesus was the healer, so there was faith there, but he didn't hear that we have record of any message about him talking about the kingdom or healing, but yet he knew, because he loved this man so much, he needed a miracle, and he had heard about the testimonies. Come on. Did you know testimonies can build your faith?
Yes.
Too many times we get religious, we've got to have the word. Yes, we do, but not that way. Not your way. So here's what happens is this. He says, no. He goes, I'm a man with authority. But I'm also a man under authority. But because I have authority, I've got those underneath me that submit to my authority. He said these words. He goes, if I say to this one, go, he goes. If I say to this one, come here, he comes. He says, whatever I tell them to do, they do it. I understand authority. And because of that, I am submitting my authority underneath your authority, so you don't have to come to my house. All you've got to do is speak the word of commandment. Doing the word is also speaking the word, not just confessing, hoping something will work. I mean, it's using it. It's using it as a sword. It's not using it as a roulette table. Sickness. Craps! You'll get that. All right, anyway, so. The centurion answered and said, Lord, I'm not worthy that you should come under my house or my roof, but speak the word only, and my servant shall be healed. And he goes on, I'm a man under authority, having soldiers under me. And I say to this one, go, he goes. This one comes, he comes. And he says, do this, and he does it. And Jesus marveled. Come on now, look at this. You are with Jesus, the Word. You are a disciple. You're following the one who's got all this Word and is the Word. You're hearing one great message after another. His teaching is phenomenal. Teaching as one not like the scribes, but having authority. He's seeing results. He's seeing teaching, preaching, and manifestations of what he's been preaching. And then you turn to the ones that have been hearing this and marvel and say, I've not seen such great faith, no, not in all of Israel. He may have said also, my disciples. I would not have wanted to have been in that crowd at that time. That centurion put everyone on blast. He busted their faith. So it tells me that until you understand your authority, you won't understand your faith. You won't understand who you are in Christ. You won't understand you're a king's kid instead of looking at a black person alongside of tracks. Do you need a group hug? Come on. Just quickly so we can get back to it. Do you need a hug? I'm telling you, stop thinking that you don't got what it takes. God thought you did. God has never had a vision of any one of us in here failing. Get that in your head. When he called you and I to minister, when he called you and I to do his works, when he called you and I to do his kingdom, he never saw any one of us failing. Ah, oh, come on. He's never seen you in foreclosure. He's never seen you with the tax collector. He's never seen it like that. Because what he did see was in Jesus. He didn't ever see it in you. He saw it in his son 2,000 years ago. So what he sees in you is conquering. What he sees in you is victory. What he sees in you is not sickness, but health. What he sees in you is prosperity. Come on. Never be guilty about God's favor on your life.
Yes. Yes.
Mm. Yes. Look at your neighbor and say, I can raise the dead. Look at your other neighbor and say, what? I'm sorry, was I asleep? All right, now. He said, I'm a man under authority. And he goes on, he says unto him, from this day forward, it actually said from that selfsame hour that the servant was healed. Glory to God. Real quickly, Matthew chapter 9, verse 35. Again, he said this. Jesus
went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing every sickness, every disease among the people. One of the things we have to get in our hearts is that when Jesus says we can do it, then we can do it. Stop waiting until you have enough training and schooling. Stop waiting until you've been to a place to where, oh, I've got this much ministry under my belt. Stop waiting until you've heard one more message. Come on. Stop waiting until you bought one more CD. Stop waiting until you go to one more service. Start acting on it right now, because God called you to do it right now. This is what I love about this group here. How long have you been saved, honestly?
1 year.
1 year. And he's got that much word in him. He's writing that much word. What about you?
2 years.
2 and a half. 1. And the girls that are with him aren't even saved. You see what I'm saying? Now, I'm just messing with them. I am teasing. I know you're huge. I'm kidding. Now listen, these guys have been doing this a little bit longer than a year. They got saved, but they're already stepping out with what God's called them to do. Not everybody's going to have a pulpit ministry. I understand that. But that doesn't mean you won't have pulpit power. You may not have a pulpit ministry, but everywhere you go, you've got pulpit power. And that means this. That means everybody that you lay hands on, if you start believing it, you should get a little frustrated, like, hey, how come they didn't get healed right away? Lord, what was the situation there? You know, we saw some amazing miracles last night. One lady had had back pain for 10 years, completely just restored after 10 years. Constant pain. Another lady, David's mom, she had had surgery in her neck and throat or something, had metal screws in her neck and everything. God told me to pop her on the back, the side of her neck, and it popped, and then I heard a thud. Not from my hand or from her falling, but for in her neck, a thud. And I said, did you hear that? She goes, yeah. She started moving her head. She goes, that's the first time since the surgery she's had no pain. 6 years since she had the surgery. And a lady with a hip, remember? Just legs growing out. Crazy stuff. That happens also outside of the church setting. Your husband delivered 30 years of smoking. Your shoulder completely healed. Glory to God. Yeah. Miracles still happen. Healing still manifest. And God is looking at you and I to do His works in the earth. Come on, are you getting anything tonight? Come on now. Let's just close this up here real quick. Matthew 19. Jesus went everywhere, teaching, preaching, and healing. He was bringing revelation, inspiration, and demonstration. Thank you, Jesus. In Matthew 19, let's go in here in verse 1. And it came to pass that when Jesus had finished these sayings, He departed from Galilee and came into the coast of Judea beyond Jordan, and great multitudes followed Him, and He healed them there. Now you may think, well, I've read that a bunch of times. What's the big deal? Read it again. Great multitudes followed Him, and He healed them there. So that tells me something, a couple of things. But you wouldn't think it would with such a short verse. Great multitudes followed Him, and He healed them there. There has a lot to do with where you see the miracles. When He says, Go right now to that woman and give her that word. Or go right there and pray with her right now. You don't have to have a bubbly unction with a bunch of goose pimples and a bunch of shundamahias flying out of your mouth before you run over. As a matter of fact, I hope you didn't. That might scare the bejesus out of that woman. But anyway, you go over there and you just be normal. And say, you know what? We saw at McDonald's. Don't let me forget to exhort on that. But we were at McDonald's. We were